So what is the effect of frequency domain sampling? Frequency domain sampling on the time domain. So remember, the DFT has samples both in the time domain and the frequency domain. So if we have, let's say here, a frequency spectrum, so that's our frequency spectrum, so that's K, the frequency index. And so remember, K just represents samples, yeah, so that's just index. And then here we've got our X of K, so that's our spectrum, and I just draw the amplitude of this, what you usually would do. So let's say that's a classical spectrum here, which looks like this. So it's mirrored, and so we have the midpoint here, that's n half, and then this goes up to n minus 1 and starts at 0, and so that corresponds to fs half, so our Nyquist frequency, and this here corresponds to dc. Remember, this is not usually not normalized and needs to divide by n. But yeah, so we're just looking here at the sample. So that's not continuous here how I've drawn this here, but these are just discrete samples. So that actually looks like that. So we have here discrete samples, and these are called frequency samples. So the question is now, what is the effect that we have only discrete number of samples here? So there's no sample in between. So therefore we have a certain frequency resolution here. Yeah. So this results in a frequency resolution. So what does it mean? So we have. We cannot distinguish between frequencies which are lie between here. Yeah, so that's the lowest one. So let's just look at an example. So what does that mean? So let's continue here on this slide. So example. So let's draw this here again, our spectrum. So that goes to n minus 1 and starts at 0, and in the middle we have got the n half for the Nyquist frequency. Yeah, so imagine now we have a sampling rate of 1 kilohertz, and we have and our n is 1,000 samples. So then we know that if n half, that corresponds to fs half, then obviously one sample here, so this one here, so this width here, this delta f here, so the frequency represented here. So this then leads us to a resolution of 1 hertz. Because 1 kilohertz divided by 1,000 gives us 1 hertz. Yeah, so that's here the result out of this here. And so this came out of here dividing 1 kilohertz by 1000. So then obviously if we do a bit higher resolution, so we say at when we do n 2000, then this means we have two times more. So therefore this essentially means that we have another tick here in the middle. So this then means we have suddenly 0.5 hertz resolution. And so on and so on. So we can just, if we just make it increase our number of samples, we are increasing the resolution. But obviously it takes more time to calculate that. And so therefore that's the effect of the frequency sampling. So we see the time domain effect now comes out here, that this here defines essentially the lowest frequency. Yeah, so the higher the n we have, the lower the frequency are. So we cannot no longer distinguish between lower frequencies. So with n equals 2000, so the 0.5 hertz is that's the lowest frequency possible what we can get. Yeah, so therefore this defines our lowest frequencies. So now let's do this in the analytics to see how this can be derived. Let's do now the analytics of this. So how do we see that? So let's write down our Fourier transform, our discrete Fourier transform again here. So that's n equals from minus infinity to plus infinity, x of n, and then e2 minus j 2 pi of n kn. So now this is not exactly our discrete Fourier transform, because the boundary is running from minus infinity to plus infinity. Remember, in the proper discrete Fourier transform, this would be from 0 to n minus 1. But because we would like to check how the effect is on an infinite time series here, we just sneaking in the infinite sign here. So this is basically an infinite series. And so what we would like to do now, we would like to go back to our back to discrete Fourier transform. Okay, so the trick is similar to the one we have done before. So if we divide this formula up here into chunks of n. So let's do that, x of k, and then this is here l equals minus infinity to plus infinity. So, and then we are creating our chunks with this l variable here. So ln, and then this runs to ln plus n plus 1. And then we just write the same from above here again, minus j 2 pi divided by n kn. So we see already we are slowly getting we are slowly going towards our DFT. So the next step is just by moving again our ln here into the formula here, so that we are reaching basically our DFT here. Oops, and this is here a negative sign, not to mix it up with a plus sign, because we're just running to n minus 1 here. Okay, so let's do this now. Let's swap these two summation signs. Okay, so let's move the ln into our x there. So it's still running from minus infinity to plus infinity. And so now we've got here the second sum is running now from n minus 1
what we want to have for the DFT, and we move this now our ln in here, so this gives us e2 minus j 2 pi divided by n, and this is here k n. So now the ln has moved in here, and that's the same trick we used before. So now the next step is just swap these two summation signs here, swap them. So let's say this is now xk, and so now the our n index is running now here, and then we have our L index inside, and this is running from minus infinity to plus infinity, and now we have n minus ln, so the x is still the same, and then e2 minus j 2 pi divided by n k n. So now we see something here, so this looks like a periodic repetition. And this one here looks like our proper inverse discrete Fourier transform. So let's write down our sum here again. So we have got L is running from minus infinity to plus infinity here, and then we've got our x n l n in here, and so we could call this x infinity here, because it's essentially running in time from negative infinity to plus infinity here in the sample domain. So how does it look like in our plot here? So we've got here our n minus 1 somewhere. So that's our n now in the sample time domain here. That's our x infinity n. So imagine now we've got a signal which looks like that. Then this signal would repeat here the same, and so on and so on. So it would repeat here. So we're getting copies. So again, as long as the signal is shorter than this n minus 1, then everything is fine. But imagine we have a signal which is longer than this, so something like that, and then this starts here again, then we're getting the same ambiguity here as before. So we are getting here ambiguity. And remember what we talked about before with our example, where we had fs equals 1 kilohertz, and we had n equals 1000, that's the lowest frequency we could represent, or the lowest time resulting out of this was 1 second, because the lowest frequency was so f min was 1 hertz. And so this means that if we are representing, for example, a signal which has 0.1 hertz, then this won't work anymore. So this is represented here. So if we have a wave which is longer than this n minus 1 here, this would overlap and can no longer be represented. So that's the effect of the sampling here in the frequency domain, that we are getting a lowest frequency, and so therefore we can only represent a certain hump at a certain duration.